In the dark and lonely hours, I listen for your voice to calm my fears. As I stare into the quietness, my heart beating alone is all I hear. But I know that you are near me, even when I cannot hear you. We are never far apart. You are here within my heart, and the love that you have given is all I'll ever need to make it through. I put my hope and trust in you, 'cause I know the love that loves beyond. And that the blood of Christ can still wash away each stain. I know a love. And in the time of endless questions, there is only one truth I need to know, that it's your love that surrounds me, a love that will not ever let me go. And I know that you are faithful when in human eyes it's hopeless. So I cling to you alone, and you make your presence known, and so tenderly you hold me and remind me that this love I found is true. So I will trust alone in you, 'cause I know a love that loves beyond all limits. I know a God whose arm is strong to save, and I know a grace whose power is all sufficient. And I know the blood of Christ, it can still wash away each stain. Darkness comes, it won't overwhelm my soul, 'cause my hope is in my God, and this I know, that there is a God who never changes, and there is a love that is faithful and true. Each day.
because you know that love today, amen? And it's because of that love that we're here today to celebrate the wonderful workings of the Lord, the miracle that he has wrought, and we're here to praise his name. So would you stand and let's give the Lord a praise offering right from the beginning of this ceremony. His presence is here. His glory is in this room today. Just like he was at the first marriage in Cana, his glorious presence is here. We bless you, Lord, and we thank you. We welcome your Holy Spirit. We give this service to you, Father. We thank you, God, that everything that has happened thus far has been done by the hand of the Holy Spirit. And we praise you and we glorify you for what you've done. We rejoice that you're a faithful God and you never, ever fail. Thank you, Jesus. So we dedicate this service to you. We'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated.
Good afternoon. Jim is going to come back and lead us in some more worship in a moment. And that really does set the tone for this gathering today. Anna and I feel very, very rejoiced to be here, just as I know each one of you do. This is not only a remarkable moment, but it's a moment of enormous significance, I think we all would agree, not simply because it's the couple that it is, though that in no way is a trivial matter. But it's so significant because of the statement it makes about the living church, its capacity in prayer, its capacity to let the Holy Spirit shape its people. Celebration of the moment is evidenced by the presence of many leaders of congregations from around the world. The reason for many of these up here are not simply their renown, but they deserve to sit there because they have more air miles than most of us here. As I have with a handful of other people, been processing recent months beside this couple and watching the Lord take two very yielded and shapeable servants and remold the very beautiful, if you will, vessel of a marriage. It's a humbling thing to watch people live out, as all of us are called to do, which incidentally is probably as much of the message we need to receive today as there is, that all of us need to constantly be reshaped to become what the Lord has for us. Different things bring us to the points of that reshaping, refashioning. The body of Christ, no part of it has not had many within it. Probably, I would dare say the total would be millions, who hearing of the temporary interruption of a marriage which brought the conclusion of one and now occasions its resumption is an occasion for celebration, but it's an occasion for letting the Holy Spirit instruct us. I am deeply moved, as I know you are. As the day progresses, we'll come to times of, I suppose, all the way through to just outright laughter and rejoicing in many ways. If no other reason to laugh, it's a joyful expression of that, what we all feel. But the tone of this occasion is one to let our hearts be softened together with gratitude and to be imprinted by the Lord as they're softened with his call to you and me. Always retain a childlike adjustment, correction, instruction, and fresh imprint, because it's only the children who get the kingdom. And that's the word of God. Amen. So except you become as little children, that calls to keeping teachable. Tell somebody, that's today's message. God bless you. Let's come into the presence of the King with worship as Jim comes to direct us together in worship.
Would you stand as we worship the Lord? What better way to begin this ceremony, this service, by giving praise and glory to our Lord and Savior who has done great things. Amen. Let's lift the name of the Lord as we sing and bless his holy name.
I sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and great.
Is here, we celebrate him. Majesty, worship his majesty, worship his majesty. For unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Sing of his majesty.
So exalt, lift up on high the
There is something about the wedding at Cana that says it all. Jesus shows up at the wedding, and he takes ordinary water and turns it into the extraordinary. And it is that phenomenon that illustrates everything about the human situation. The fact is, statistically, scientifically, we are 98% water. That's a fact. And if there's anything we need, it's Jesus to come to weddings and to touch the water and turn it from just the plain into the extraordinary. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So we've invited him here today with our worship and with our prayer. And with that, we come to the time of welcoming the presence of a very, very dear friend. Reinhard Bonnke is here with us today, and Reinhard is going to be sharing in a bit. And right now, I think if we can get the bridal party to line up, do you think you could welcome them into the room? I'm not looking for an applause. Wait till they get here. I think so.
Be seated. Seated. Marriage is ordained by God and is the cornerstone of family life and the hope of an honorable society.
It was instituted when God united Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And Jesus honored its celebration by his ministry in Cana of Galilee. The relationship of marriage is used to describe the union between Christ and his church. And Paul instructs the husband to love his wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Man and woman find the answer to their deepest needs in each other as they are united in marriage when both enter into this covenant with true Christian humility, faith, and love. The ideal marriage is a loving relationship in which each uses all that he or she has and is able to do for the benefit and happiness of the other, undergirded by the love of God. Thus, two people, forsaking all others, become one flesh, one in thought, one in purpose and hope, in all the concerns of this present life and the life to come. Into this state of holy matrimony, Benny and Suzanne renew their vows and enter into the covenant relationship of marriage. Who gives Suzanne to Benny?
Voglio una vita nuova,
Just said to Benny and Suzanne, I said, had you seen that before? That letter from the kids is just, that's a killer, isn't it? I need to regroup my own emotions right now. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. 58 years in the ministry for me has seen a transition in our culture, which all of us have seen at different stages. I appreciate so much, Paul, your uncle, Suzanne, reading material that I have heard over the years, but we don't hear it often enough these days. There's something of a quest to somehow customize marriage that really the demands of marriage in the light of the Word of God recommend not customizing to the point that you lose the heartbeat of what it's really about. And I so value that, and your dad is coming in a moment to share as well. At this point, I want to read from the old Episcopal prayer book, which contained the Church of England opening, early part of the opening of the ceremony. And what it is, it has a portion that is called when the bride and groom make their vows. There is the vows, and earlier there's what is called the inquiry, which goes all the way back to land holdings and things about disclosure that were really had more to do with property than the married couple. But included in that was what is called the charge. I want to read this to you and then make what was the bride and groom's inquiry preceding to the vows. It incorporates the agreement to them, but not the vows themselves. I require and charge you both that you will answer on the day of judgment when the secret of hearts will be disclosed. As if there's anything you know that would hinder this, to confess it. Be assured that people join in marriage otherwise than God's word allows. That the marriage, the old book said, is not lawful. So much is lawful in our day that that's really immaterial and never read. The beauty about coming to this marriage with you is how much, first, that you've experienced of life together already. The miracle, of course, is this resumption. We call it as elements of reunion. In a sense, in the hands of God, the loose ends never were let go. And your hearts had the weeping and the pain that comes from what was temporary. And in that, just kept submitted to the Lord on both ends of that and let Him, thank you, Jesus, bring it all together. And here we are, all beneficiaries of this precious moment. And so, not as though there was not an earlier date that this order of thing took place, but because it takes place in an entirely a new environment. And the richness of the years you still have, the abundance, you're going to see great great-grandchildren someday, like Anna and I have. There's so many coming right now. There's like a fig tree in your backyard with figs dropping off the tree about every other day. And you're going to experience this. I can't tell you how I rejoice with you, and all of us do with you. Can I hear an amen in the room? Well, we know the answer to this, but I want to seal it in the presence of the Lord. I want to ask first, Benny, will you have Suzanne to be your wedded wife, to live together with her after God's ordinance in the holy state of marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep only unto her as long as you both shall live? And Suzanne, from this ancient recitation that says so much, I ask, will you, Suzanne, take Benny to be your wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy state of marriage? Will you obey and serve him, love, honor, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep only unto him so long as you both shall live? Well, you didn't surprise me by your responses. But I wanted, in thinking so soberly as actually your trial and this victory through trial brings all of us to a place of evaluating, and the influence we bring to bear upon our children, and by the grace of God, something of a stamp through this on many of this generation. God bless you. Now your dad comes to exhort and encourage you both. Roy.
You all pray for me. I was doing well until I walked down the aisle. What should be a time of rejoicing, I express in tears. So grateful to God. And those of you who prayed for this day, I smile through my tears. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. My purpose in being here today, Benny and Suzanne have been, I've been counseling with them for several months. They've asked me to share with you publicly what some of the things I've been sharing with them privately. And so I will. There's a plaque in the home where I grew up in England that I still remember. And I shared this with Suzanne and Benny. Christ is the head of this home, the unseen guest at every meal and the silent listener to every conversation. And I'm believing God that today, as Benny and Suzanne renew their vows, that this will be true in their home. And I know it will. Much has been said already about the family. And the family is the basic unit of the kingdom. Before God instituted any institution on the earth, he first established the family. Before the church, we had the family. Before nations, we had the family. Before civil government, we had the family. And God was so concerned that we get it right that he did the first wedding himself. And we're here to celebrate this holy moment. The Bible is filled with weddings. In fact, the Bible begins and ends with a wedding. The first one was conducted by the Lord, and the second one will be conducted by the Lord. The first one took place in Eden, and the second one will take place in Revelation 19 in heaven at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Jesus himself was and is a family man. He could have been born in the temple. He could have been born in a synagogue, but he chose to be born in a home with the security and the love of a godly mother, a hardworking father, several brothers, and at least two sisters. I shared with Benny and Suzanne seven principles that my wife and I have tooled out to build a happy Christian home. There are more than seven, but I like the number seven. Seven is God's number. It's the number of perfection. It's the number of completion. And when Benny and Suzanne came for counseling, I said, you know, the strongest unit is the relationship between husband and wife. And Jesus said in Matthew 18, verse 19, if two shall agree. And the word agree comes, if you anglicize the Greek word, you have the word symphonize or symphony. And those of you who've been attending, have ever attended a symphony orchestra, you know what happens. When those instruments come together, they sound more like a chorus of dying cats. But finally, they get the same tune on the same note. And when they sing, when they play, it's beautiful harmony. It's beautiful symphony. So I shared with Benny and Suzanne these seven principles that my wife and I have learned, and I have no degree in marriage counseling. But in 62 years of marriage, I've learned the hard way at times how to make a marriage work. Most of my peers thought I was a successful pastor, had the largest church in Florida. But I was a lousy husband and a lousy father. I had to learn from experience. And out of experience, I share with Benny and Suzanne, and I share with you, that there must be an agreement in the meaning of love. I was driving the other day, and behind a truck, it says, I love my dog. That's the same word we use when we say, I love my wife. It has little meaning in the English language, but in the Greek language, there are three basic words. Number one is eros. Eros is physical love. We get the word erotic from eros. And there has to be agreement in physical love. The second is filial, brotherly love, friendship love. But the highest level of love is agape. It's the God kind of love. The definition of love is found in 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. And the meaning is, love is it's not an emotion. Emotion is the byproduct of love. Love is action and reaction. We love the Lord because he first loved us. And love is a sacrificial choice that seeks the highest and the best for the one who's the object of your love. And I've said that to Benny and him, Benny and Suzanne several times, that love is a sacrificial choice that seeks the highest and the best for the one who's the object of your love. Number two, there must be agreement on spiritual issues. Jesus was prophet and priest by divine right. But according to Philippians 2, he had to earn the right to be king. Benny is prophet and priest at the home by divine right, but he also has to earn the right to be king. And spiritual values must be in place and must be agreed on. Number three, there must be agreement in communication. And I smile when I think of this because women don't think right. But the problem is, they're usually right. Men think with their head and women think with their heart, making no sense at all, but they're right. And then, of course, there is the silent treatment. And the husband says, honey, what's wrong? Nothing. She's lying. And then the typical cliche for the husband, he says, honey, what's wrong? And when she tells him, he says, that's no problem. I remember some years ago, I see my beloved wife on the front row. Some years ago, she came to me, she said, Roy, I have a problem. What's the problem? She told me the problem. I said, honey, that's no problem. It was a problem, major problem. But I said, it's no problem. Several days later, she came back. She said, Roy, I have a problem. What's the problem? Same problem. Honey, that is no problem. She came back a little while later. She said, Roy, I really have a problem, because if I don't have a problem, and I think I have a problem, I must really have a problem. Guess what I said? No problem. Until Pauline came back a few days later, she said, Roy, I really have to talk. I have a problem. And she said, if you will not listen to me, would you mind if I drive down to Lakeland and talk to Carl and Joyce Strait about my problem? I said, honey, why don't we sit down and talk about your problem? There must be agreement in communication. Next, there must be agreement on the stewardship of finances. There's no pressure any greater than financial pressure. Next, there must be agreement on the disciplining of children, because usually one is a little tougher, aren't they, Suzanne? And one is a little more lenient, aren't they, Benny? I'm not saying anything, but there must be agreement in dealing with children. And even when children get to be married, you can help them to fail unless there's agreement on disciplining the children. Next, and I'm almost through, next, there must be agreement in how to handle in-laws. I had a godly father, but he was tough. Pauline had a godly mother, but she was tough. We had to sit down and decide how we would handle our in-laws. The best thing that ever happened to Pauline and me, we left England, the place of our birth, and we came away 3,000 miles. We had to die or fly. Thank God Suzanne has never made the mistake of turning to Benny and saying, I'm going home to Mama. Agreement on dealing with in-laws is important. And finally, understanding and having an agreement in our sexual motivation and our sexual drives. I gave to Benny and Suzanne a confession that I believe will help strengthen their marriage. Now, I know positive faith confession has been ridiculed and rejected by many people. It is now the blab it and grab it doctrine, or the name it, claim it, frame it doctrine. No, it is a vital, important, exciting truth of the word. The Bible says in Hebrews 3, verse 1, verse chapter 14, verse chapter 4, verse 14, and chapter 10, verse 23, that there is a benefit in positive faith confession. The Bible says that Christ is the high priest of our confession, which means what I confess on earth is given to my high priest in heaven, and he in turn presents my confession of faith to the Father, and the Father commissions the Holy Spirit to make good on the earth what I confess in faith. And here's the confession they've asked me to share with you. We confess that our marriage was made in heaven. We confess that we are joined together in matrimony by our Heavenly Father, the Lord God Almighty. We confess that our wedding vows were made not only to a minister, but to the Lord Jesus Christ himself. We confess that Christ is the head of our home, the silent guest at every meal, and the silent listener to every conversation. We confess that our wedding was sealed by the Holy Spirit. Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and he's stolen our unity, the joy, and the peace of our marriage. But in Jesus' name, we command he give us back every blessing he's stolen from us. We overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And we declare that because of the blood, divorce has no power over us. Hallelujah. And because of the blood, divorce has no place in our marriage relationship. With the sword of the Spirit, the spoken word of God, we cut ourselves free from every attack of the enemy in his attempt to destroy our marriage, because the Bible declares that our home is to be heaven on earth. We pray daily for our marriage and for the family, because our faith-filled words have power to create a happy, Christ-centered home, and because our faith-filled words have authority over all the power of the enemy, we will hold fast our confession of faith without wavering, because he is faithful who promised. Finally, we confess that we will promise to obey the word of God, and I, Benny, will pray that God will give me the grace to love Suzanne as Jesus loved the church and gave himself. And I, Suzanne, will pray that God will give me the grace to submit to Benny as unto the Lord, because our attitude and our actions toward one another reflect our actions and our attitudes toward the Lord. Benny and Suzanne sincerely have made their vows. They have sought godly counsel. And I am one delighted papa to stand here for the second time. And this time it's going to work. And everybody, and everybody said, amen.
Would that every daddy in the world could stand before his kids when they're getting married and say those words. Amen to that. We come then to those vows for you to exchange. And as I mentioned, over a half century of performing wedding ceremonies. In the 1970s, when people started doing everything from getting married in a diving bell to a swimming pool to in a hot air balloon or whatever else, and vows were randomly made and everybody wanted to write their own. Came an occasion when we began to, I wish you'd have been around, Roy, we'd have had you come over and teach several seminars, because we began to present things to say these are the things that count. Last evening, I reviewed these with you not to get your approval, because I knew you had that, but the purpose now of this recitation that you will make is a declaration which, in accord with what your dad just said, with which I agree, the confession of our lips begets a word of prophecy when spirit-filled people say, this is it. This is what we're doing. God will bring those things into being. We rejoice in that light. Benny, will you repeat after me to Suzanne? Because God has brought us together. Again, because God has brought us together.
God has brought us together.
And has established our love and our relationship.
I,
Benny, take you, Suzanne, to be my beloved wife. I will love you as my wife, as Christ loved the church. Through whatever joy or trial we face, I promise to honor the Holy Spirit's guidance, so that I may lead us in God's way. I pledge myself to you in this lifelong commitment, because you were made for me. I will never leave you or separate myself from you. I will to become all God wills me to be for you. Suzanne, I believe in his power and in his promise to fulfill this commitment. So here and now, I give you everything of myself that I am and shall be, in Jesus' name. Suzanne, if you'll repeat after me, I would like the groom to wait until the appropriate time to kiss. She still has to make her vows. You don't know that she even wants to kiss you yet. Roy, after your very tender, tear-jerking thing, we needed this laugh break here. Suzanne, Benny, I also believe it's God's perfect desire for me to become your wife. And so I receive you today as my beloved husband. As you have committed your life and love to me, so I give you mine. And in full confidence, I submit myself to you as my lifelong partner. Where you go, I will go. You were made for me. And I will never leave you or separate myself from you. And together we will serve our God. Benny, I also pledge myself to become all God wants me to be to you. I too believe in his power and his promise to fulfill this commitment. And so therefore, I here and now give you everything of myself that I am and shall be. In Jesus' name. May we have the rings, please. The rings that we wear have a history, a time which rings reaching back 10th, 11th, 12th century were called signet rings. There are such still today, of course. But they were used so frequently in that time that they would use it stamping in the melted wax that was put on documents to authenticate that these were vows or covenants being made. And we put this signet, with a signet ring into the melted wax. We come, and with every kind of emotion we're experiencing together with you, a softening of our hearts before the Lord. Wherever the word of this goes, it will be a similar experience for people in this moment for the two of you. That as you exchange those rings, that they are sealing vows. The Bible speaks of the Holy Spirit who seals, does the sealing work. And so with that in mind, I want, Benny, for you to put that on Suzanne's finger and repeat after me. Suzanne, I give this ring as a constant of my abiding, as a symbol of my constant abiding love for you. I give you my name and all that I am. I seal the vows that I have made to you with this ring in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'll repeat after me, Suzanne. I too give this ring as a symbol of my constant abiding love for you. I receive your name and give you myself. And with this ring, seal the vows before the presence of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Benny and Suzanne wanted this event to be celebrated in a way that I can think exceeds no other foundational point of reference that could be greater. And that's by the honoring of the power of the cross, the receiving of the Lord's table, and the dear friend of so many of us and of theirs, of course, Reinhard Bonnke is coming to direct us together as a congregation, as well as the bride and groom in this. Reinhard?
Praise God. Benny and Suzanne, I'm deeply moved by what is happening here. This is just too wonderful. And I feel, when I sat there, I just felt as if a river of the balm of Gilead is flowing across the world from here into millions of broken marriages. An impulse for healing and renewal. What is happening here is too wonderful to describe. And I think it's wonderful also to celebrate here Holy Communion in the name of Jesus. May I be allowed just to say one or two lines? What's on my heart? You know, speaking about the perfect marriage. A perfect marriage requires a perfect husband and a perfect wife. And I tell you what I think a perfect husband is. A perfect husband is the one who doesn't expect his wife to be perfect. And the perfect wife is the one that doesn't expect her husband to be perfect. But both have a perfect Savior. Amen. And his name is Jesus. Wedlock is a lock. Because the clause in this contract is till death separates us. But wedlock is not padlock. It's not a jail. It's a paradise. It's harmony. It's fulfillment. And I believe that you will enter a phase in your life that will radiate these very qualities. Hallelujah. Glory to God in the highest. God planned the first wedding. And you know how he planted? He first created the universe. Then he created the earth, the animals. Then he created Adam and Eve. And then he rolled out a green carpet for the first couple. And then he beckoned them. And he said he wanted to bless them. They didn't know what blessing was. That word, I think they had never heard before. It was God's invention. And right now, I believe Jesus is beckoning you to his table to bless you, your marriage, your family, your children, your grandchildren, those you have and those you shall have. Glory to God. And that brings us to the table of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. For I have received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. What strikes me here is this. The same night humanity committed the greatest betrayal ever, the same night we did the worst, the same night he did his best. What a wonderful Jesus. What a wonderful Lord. And he had given thanks, he broke and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We will do that in a moment. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do. As you drink it in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. New covenant means New Testament. This is the New Testament in solid form. And when we are going to drink the cup, you and all of us, we drink the New Testament in its liquid form. All of it. And the blessings of the Lord shall be your portion forever in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Glory to God in the highest. Now the moment has come. I would like to serve Holy Communion to you, Penny and Suzanne, and everyone here will be able to partake and participate. Everyone born again has the right and is called to the table of the Lord in Jesus' name. Amen. Take it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. I would just like to say one more thing about 1 John 1:7. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from every sin. Fellowship with God is possible, but only by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus makes this type of fellowship possible. And if you want to glue two objects together, the two surfaces have first to be cleansed and cleaned, and then the glue will hold. I believe with all of my heart the blood of Jesus has done its wonderful work in your lives and in all our lives. Today you will become glued together with the super glue of God's love in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So I believe celebrating the Holy Communion is such a symbol in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I would like to serve you the bread. Amen. Lord, I want to thank you for this wonderful bread, a symbol of your body broken for us, broken for my dear brother Penny, for my dear sister Suzanne. We thank you that we can eat it and that it becomes part of it. You have a part in us, and we have a part in you, in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And in the same manner, he gave them the cup and said, drink, a new testament in my blood. The New Testament, the New Covenant. This is so special. And it will solidify in your lives, in your marriage, in your family and home, in Jesus' name. God bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shall we pray? Shall we pray? Oh, Lord, we praise you. Let's praise him. Lord, we praise you. We praise you for the miracle that you have done. Thank you for this immense miracle of remarriage. Thank you, Lord, that millions of marriages across the world will be affected as a result of it. Healing shall flow from this moment across the globe and around the globe a million times in Jesus' name. And bless each and every one present here. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody shout amen.
The ushers are going to serve you communion as we worship the Lord together, and then Brother Reinhardt will lead us in receiving the communion.
There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not, as thou hast been thou forever.
All I have needed, thy hand has brought.
her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and he sought her to be his holy bride with his own blood.
Foundation for all of us and for you as well. Have we all received the emblems now? Okay. Then, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Please do it now in remembrance of him, our blessed Lord Jesus Christ. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Do it now in remembrance of him, the new covenant in his blood. What precious cup. We belong to Jesus, and Jesus belongs to us. Father, we want to thank you that you sent your Son into this world. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for the great sacrifice you made. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. To save Israel, you sent Moses, and you sent Joshua and others. To save us, you sent nobody. You came yourself. And we thank you, Lord, that we are participants of this wonderful and glorious salvation. In Jesus' name, and everybody grateful, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
First, Benny and Suzanne, thank you for inviting us all to come together as Jesus has invited us all to come to the table as often as we will to do it in remembrance of him. And so the sealing of that, you have sealed your vows verbally before one another. You've sealed them by the giving and receiving of a ring, and you've sealed them in the presence of a celebration of the covenant of the eternal love of God to us through the blood and the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. And this threefold seal brings me to the point of the privilege. It's called the pronouncement. And before I do that, I want to say to all that are here that the customarily immediately following the pronouncement is the presentation of the bride and groom. And we usually all have an explosion at that point. You'll probably have a minor one with my cautions that there's more yet to come. With no facetiousness at all, I think there's a beauty at this particular time. Benny said, "I want to pray a blessing over Suzanne at this time." It was their desire that we celebrate as we have, wants to do that. And Benny said, "I also would like to express thanks to people that are here that have come, especially those that have gone to great lengths to come, but certainly to all." And then he said, "I really want to lead the people for just a few minutes in worship before the throne, and with my bride be here before them, and for all of us to worship together in song, just as we've worshiped together in partaking the cup." Following that, there will be the presentation of them. But right now, having exchanged the vows and sealed them in the triple fashion that we have, and in the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit, Benny, you may kiss the bride. Let's join together as Benny, you go ahead and proceed in that time of prayer. And there's also, following that, your dad is coming back again, Suzanne, to speak a benediction over both of you. Go ahead, Benny.
I'd like you all to stand, and we want to worship the Lord. This has been very precious, very moving. But first, can we just give the Lord a mighty hand of praise? As you remain standing, we want to enter for just a few moments in the presence of the Lord and honor Him, because He's the one who's done this. Sue and I are grateful that you came today, all of you. And we want to say thank you, of course, first to the Lord and then to you, His people. So let's just lift our hands and bless Him. Jesus, Jesus, precious, wonderful Jesus. Lord, I thank you for your goodness and your mercy and your grace that is so abundant and so awesome. I thank you for this moment with Suzanne by my side, my bride, that you gave me many years ago. And today you've restored us because of your mercy. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your mercy. Where would we be without it? And Lord, I pray that as your servant Pastor Jack has said already, and as your servant Ronald Bunke has said already, that many homes will be healed as a result. In Jesus' mighty name, glorify your name, Jesus, and only your name, for your glory and your honor. Come on, let's bless Him with how great thou art, how fitting it is. The first time I heard this song was in Catherine's meeting. I didn't even know the words back then, but the God we serve is a mighty God. So when we lift our hands now and really sing it, how great thou art, let's sing it with all our hearts. Come on, let's bless Him. Then sing. Jesus, we worship you tonight. Let's lift our hands and love him and believe that he will touch our homes and our lives. I pray your presence will become so real to each one of us as we stand and worship you. Dearest Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for the future that's greater than our yesterday. That your presence will be rich in our lives daily for your sake. See him now at God's right hand as you love him. Hallelujah. you, Lord, for your dear presence. And now we also thank you for our families. We thank you for our moms and our dads. We pray you'll bless them. Keep them alive for a little while longer and healthy, that they may see the years of joy before they go home. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you remain standing, please, I want to do something that's kind of a surprise. I'll never get this chance again. I want to ask my mom to come on and stand next to Suzanne, and Pauline to come stand next to me. So, Rose, you have to help mom. And my mom is 82. Pauline is 83. See if someone can help my mom up. And Pauline, you hold on to me, doll. And I want you to give them a great God bless you.
ولاد ولادهم يفرح بابنه يا رب يشبك تكون قلب واحد ويد واحد التنين يا رب تبعد عنهم ولاد الحرام تبعد عنهم الفساد يا رب وفقهم يباركهم انت باركهم وقف بناتهم دايما هم ولادهم وصارهم يا رب
Amen.
شكرا على بني اللي رجع لسوزان والله يوفقهم بحياتهم ويضلوا لبعض طول حياتهم يفرحوا في أولادهم في أولادهم ونورك عليهم دائما بالمنستريشيتهم
Amen.
In Jesus name
She prayed for she thanked the Lord for her restoration she prayed we would be joyful in our kids, grandkids, and great grandkids. Now, Pauline, this is a surprise, but we want you to sing. I'm going to hold you, so and I'll give you the words. And I want Roy to go on the piano. So Roy used to play for Smith Wigglesworth. And when he was 14 years old, he played piano for Smith. When he was 30, now he's 85. We may never have this moment again, Roy. I don't think we will. So if you don't mind going on the piano, and we're going to sing His Eyes on the Sparrow.
What can you say on a wedding day when Benny and Suzanne ask you to sing and play the piano? Pauline is not a singer, and I am really not a pianist, but we will obey.
Well, you most certainly can play the piano, Roy. Darling, you're singing His Eyes on the Sparrow. Why should I feel discouraged?
Why should the shadows
go? You know the song.
Yeah, I do.
Pauline used to sing operatic at her mom years ago. You know, I see my grandkids standing back there just looking. Hey, guys, come up here. Little Theo and little Benny. This is little Theo. Come up here, baby. And little Benny. Little Theo started all this right here. Come here, doll. Come here. We're going to tell him all this. Little Theo was about 6. And he said to me one day, Thanksgiving 2011, right? He said, Dad, he was sitting on my knees, excuse me.
He was sitting on my knees. I said my lips. Can you believe it? Anyways, he was sitting on my knees, and I asked him to kiss me on my lips, like this. And he hates it, so he did, and he wiped it off. And I said, don't wipe it off. He said, I'm rubbing it in, Dad. I'm rubbing it in. And then he said, Dad, when are you going to go back to Nana? Well, I didn't know what to tell him. And it touched my heart. And then he said, Dada, I am praying that Jesus will put you back together, Dada. And that was 2 years ago now or more. This is Jessica's little boy and Michael's boy right there. Both of them. This is little Benny, who is wild. We love him very, very much. You guys want to say hello? Because we'll never have this moment again.
Hi.
Come on, Benny.
Hi.
Okay, now, little Sophia is not here, so maybe we can bring her up later. And little Abigail, who's got... Haven't bring him up, guys. Let the little babies come while Nana or Grand-Nana for them is going to be singing. So, you ready?
I don't know. Yes.
Okay, Roy.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? For Jesus is my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches.
Did my fears, okay.
Though by the path he leadeth, that one step I may see. Good, keep with me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
To say thank you to all of you for sharing this moment with us and praying for us, and especially to special people who have flown from around the world. I of course need to recognize them. First of all, we're so honored to have Dr. Morris Sorello, who came all the way here.
We love him very, very much. And dear sweet Melon Hickey, who came to be with us, let's give her a big God bless you. And dear Marcus and Joni Lamb from Daystar, all the way, they're here and they've stood with Suzanne and been such a blessing to our lives. And bless you both. Thank you. And dear Paul Dinakaran, who came from India, the largest ministry in India. Paul, wave at them so they'll know who I'm talking about. And dear Chuck Hall came from Italy. Let's give him a big God bless you. Runs TBN Europe, and his wife, Pina, down here too. And Robert Gayanja from all the way from Uganda. The largest ministry there in Kampala. These wonderful pastors, and there's a group of ministers who came from Brazil. They flew in all the way from Brazil. This is Apostle Rene, the largest ministry in Manaus. I was with him a week and a half ago. 50,000 people packed the stadium. He flew in all the way. Apostle Rene, just wave at them. Give him a big, big God bless. And I see Pastor Farage from Brasilia, the largest work in Brasilia. These men flew in all the way from Brazil just for this. Can we give them another big God bless you? And I think Pastor Duke is here somewhere, unless he's in the crowd. Ron Luce, incredible to have you, brother. God bless Ron and Evan Horton and more Brazilians. And then right back there is my son. This is my son and his wife, Patricia. This is Pastor Alex Omokutu, the largest work today in the UK with a network called Belief TV, reaching all of Africa. He flew in all the way from London with his wife, Patricia. Let's give them a big, big God bless you. And Pastor Ashish, I saw you down there. You should be up here. Pastor Ashish has the largest work in Dubai. He flew with his wife all the way from the United Arab Emirates. He and his wife and his children, just wave at us again. Give him a big, big God bless you. You were to be up here, but I'm glad you came. Now, what I want to do, as just before I have dear Pastor Jack come and Roy to speak the benediction, I'd like you to remain standing and stretch your hands towards us. And pastors, stretch. In fact, if you don't mind coming, all the pastors, and just stand around us this way. And Pastor Jack, come stand next to us. And Roy, come stand next to us. I want you to bring Pauline with you. Pastor Jack and Anna. I want Anna here, standing next to Pastor Jack. I want Melon Hickey to come and stand beside Roy. I want Dr. Sorello to come and stand next to Melon Hickey, please, if you don't mind, sir. And Marcus and Joni and Paul and Chuck, come with us right here. Come just all around. Come closer, gentlemen. And ladies, come closer.
We would like Pastor Julia, Pastor Bonnie, Lois, Pastor Michelle, Cindy Jacobs to please come up too.
These are precious friends and ministers of the gospel that have prayed for us, stood with us, and there's many, many more, of course, around the world in here. And Pastor Ashish, please come up and bring your wife. Pastor Sheila, Suzanne wants you up. Please come up. The Bible says we honor those to whom honor is due. Amen. These precious pastors and ministers have flown in from throughout the world and many parts of the U.S. And this is a little different, of course, but I think it's fitting and right that I, as Suzanne's prophet and priest, lay hand on her and ask God to bless her life and bless her future. When we were married, Pastor Jack, back in 79, I laid my hands on Suzanne at Calvary Assembly, not far from here, and prayed that God would place on her the anointing on my life, for we were becoming one. Last night, she said, would you do it again? Would you lay hands on me again? And ask the Lord to anoint my life as he has touched yours. So, of course. So stretch your hands towards her. I stand today not only as your husband, but also as God's servant. And I pray for you in the presence of God and his son Jesus, in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the presence of his people, the church. And I, your husband, lay my hand on you. And I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit that rests and has rested on my life will also rest on yours for the rest of your life. For we truly are one in spirit and one in heart and one in every way, for whom God hath joined together are truly one. The Bible says they shall become one. And I, your husband, place my hand on you. And I pray God Almighty will protect you. I pray the blood of Jesus Christ will cover you for the rest of your life. I pray the Holy Spirit's power will surround your life as a blanket, never to be lifted of your soul and being. That your body will be the vessel of the Holy Spirit. That he will use you in signs and wonders and demonstrations. That souls will be saved, bodies be healed. And if I should go to heaven before you, Suzanne, that you'd carry on the gospel and the preaching of the gospel, bringing healing to the multitudes. And I pray today that Jesus, whom we serve, will anoint our children. That once we go home, Joshua, Jessica, Natasha and Alicia, Theo, Benny, Sophia and Abigail, Michael, Danny, will carry the anointing of the Holy Spirit throughout the nations of the earth and their children and the children to come. That every member of our family will preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. Pastor Jack.
Roy,
we want you to come and stand with us. I want Pastor Jack to pronounce, and then, yes, sir. Roy, go ahead and
bring the benediction.
Bring the benediction.
This is a miracle day, to be sure. It was in the 1970s when I met Benny. I was speaking at the John 17:21 rally, a convention in Singapore, and Benny and I flew back together. I didn't know him, but on that plane, 30,000 feet in the air, God told me he would be my son-in-law. Satan has fought it, but thank you, Lord, we've read the last chapter today. Jesus Christ has won. And if I may, I would like to give this as a dedication first to Benny and Suzanne. Every day when my wife and I pray together, which we do, we go through the alphabet of blessings. And I'd like to dedicate this to Benny and Suzanne. Benny, Suzanne, you are blessed because A, you're accepted in the Beloved. B, you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. C, you are chosen in Christ before the foundations of the world. E, or D, you're delivered from the power of darkness and been translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. E, you're empowered to prosper. F, you're favored by the Lord. G, you have received abundance of God's grace. H, you have the hope of a hope which is steadfast and sure. I, you have an inheritance now and for eternity. J, you have joy unspeakable and full of glory. K, you are kings and priests unto God. L, you have love that never fails. M, you have mercy. N, you are new creatures in Christ Jesus. O, you are one in and with Christ, and he is one in and with you. P, you have peace like a river. Q, you have quietness in the time of storm. R, you're redeemed by his blood. S, you have salvation. T, you have truth. U, are united. V, you have victory. W, you have wisdom. X, that stands for a mistake, and God never makes a mistake, so we'll leave the X. Y, you are yielded to the will of God. And Z, you are zealous for good works. I dedicate that to you, Benny, and to Suzanne. And now I bless you. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you, be gracious and merciful unto you, and may the blessing and favor of Almighty God follow you wherever you go all the days of your life until you stand complete in the presence of God in that day. Amen.
With that, the father of the bride and I join to present to you Pastor and Mrs. Barrett Benny Hinn. Welcome. Yeah.